yesterday. You promised we could go somewhere. You promised we could go somewhere.
Well, how about going down to Alton, to the Alton Museum today? Does that sound good?
Sure.
Sound good to you?
Sure does. Let's go.
Let's finish eating breakfast, and we'll get ready and we'll go. Okay, we'll spend the whole day down there.
History. It was a time when the white settlers were moving in and the Indians really didn't like it very much. There were 15 people killed in 4 massacres in Madison County, and I'd like to tell you about one of them. It was on the afternoon of July 10th in 1814, and it was after the War of 1812, but the Indians were still riled up about it, that Rachel Regan was babysitting with her 2 children and 2 of the Moore, George Moore family and 2 of the Abel Moore family in a log cabin out near Fosterburg Road. And the rest of the people had gone to church, and she and the 6 children decided that they would make a trip between the cabins and get some green beans for dinner that night. So they went out along this wooded trail. When the family returned from church, they found no one in the cabin. So they knew that something like what did happen must have happened. They searched through the darkness and came across some of the bodies and realized that 6 children and 1 woman had been massacred. And this is a handmade tombstone that the father of 2 of the children made in their memory. It says, William and Joel Moore were killed by Indians, July 10, 1814. This is not the typical gun of that time, but it's a gun that could have been used while they were trailing the Indians. I would like to invite you to sometime go out on the road toward Gardenmore Park, and you will see a little fenced area that is the graves of the parents of two of those children and their grandfather, who was a Revolutionary War veteran. It's a very interesting time, that time in 1814, and we're glad that it's finally settled and that no longer do we have problems between the red people and the white people. What do you think? Did you enjoy hearing about that?
Yes, okay. I thought it was really
interesting. Oh, I'm glad that you
remember, boys, when we were talking about the Wood River Massacre in 1814? Well, we're going to talk about 1816 in the Alton area. This is Margaret Weber, and she was the museum's very first president. And she knows a lot about history, and we'd like for her to tell us about early Alton, if you will, Peg.
Well, Rufus Easton was an attorney, or a lawyer, I guess they called him in those days, in St. Louis. And he became interested in Alton. He thought it would make a fine, there was no houses here then, but he thought it would make a fine place to have a city. There weren't many cities around here then, there were a few. There was Milton, which was a little settlement down near East Alton, but near the bottom of Milton Hill. And that was in about 1817, people settled there. And it was very unhealthy. It seemed like there were so many mosquitoes and it made so much malaria. And so before long, people left there. They maybe moved to Upper Alton, because in Upper Alton, it was high and dry, and not so many mosquitoes. And then they finally, when Rufus Easton came, he started a city or town down on the riverfront, because in those days, there were not many roads. And in order to go from one town to another, you had to ride a horse, or walk, or go on the river. And so he thought because of that, it would make a fine town. Now he named his town Alton. That was because he had a son by the name of Alton. And I just wonder if they came from Alton, England. Did you know there was a town in England named Alton?
Yeah.
You can see that there was not much built down here in the first days. But this was the prison where Lovejoy was killed. Not prison. This was prison. This was the building where Lovejoy was killed. This was a prison, the first prison in Illinois. There were, this maybe is up in North Alton, and this up towards Upper Alton, but they're not shown on this map very well. There's churches.
It's a little
Piso. Yeah, the Piso Creek came through the town, and now we call it Piso Street, but did you know under that street is a river, is a creek, and it's been all covered over, and must have been done pretty well, because trains used to go right over the river, over in the sewer.
Now, you remember Margaret telling you that a school teacher made this. Now, there's another lady that was very famous in our area for having been in charge of a school. You see her picture up over the mantel. Her name was Harriet Haskell. She was the head of the Monticello Female Seminary for Women for many, many years. She may have been the first liberated woman in the area, for all we know. And if you've been up on Henry Street,
hello there. This is what you heard on the stairs a while ago. This is what made those noises. That was one of the shoes that belonged to Robert Wadlow, the tallest man who ever lived. This is a shoe that he wore when he's 11 years of age. If you want to measure it against your shoe or your hands, look how big that thing is. And this is a picture, actual size, of the man just a few months before he died. He was 22 years of age, and he had just received his Masonic ring from the jeweler. And this picture was taken when the jeweler was shaking hands with him. Look how I'd have to stretch my hand to get around his. His hand was so big, he could hide a Coke bottle in his hand. You couldn't even see it. It was so big. This is just a few months before he died. Okay, we have a whole pair of these shoes. I have both of them that he wore when he's 11 years of age. And that's quite a large shoe for a young man, isn't it? But he wore a size 37 by the time he died. There are some interesting facts about Robert in this edition of the newspaper. I'd like to show you some of the things that Robert used when he was a little feller. You're 8 years old, you tell me? He used this desk when he was 9. Now, how do you fit in that? Pretty well? It'd be pretty hard to sit in that, wouldn't it? But Robert was over 6 feet tall when he went to third grade. So he weighed quite a bit and was so tall that they had to build up the desk in wooden blocks. Do you see how the desk is built up with wooden blocks to make it big enough for him? After he was in third grade and passed to the fourth grade, he usually used a chair rather than a desk because the desks were not at all suitable for him. Another thing that he used when he was a young fellow was a sled. Now look at the size of this sled. Wow. That was not especially made for him, but it was an adult-sized sled, but he grew too big for that. Can you imagine?
Wow.
He was just a big man, weighed over 200 pounds when he was using this sort of sled, and pretty soon he outgrew that, so he had to give up the joys of sleigh riding.
I'd like to show you the gown that Robert used when he graduated from high school. Look at the size of that.
Wow.
Clear from there all the way to here. It's a size 85. Most people wear about a 45 or 50 who sing in choirs, and this is size 85.
We're starting now to put pictures in here of the dedication of the statue, that is the building of it too. So some of these pages are blanks. But we have the actual dedication program in here in a lot of these pictures. These little figures are the first thing that a sculptor does when he intends to make a large figure. These are made of clay, exactly like he interprets the final statue to be. He made these small ones for the selection committee to choose the pose that they wanted. We didn't like either of the poses you see there, but this one is the best one that we thought. And so this is the one he actually used for creating the large statue. The hand holding the cane is in a good position. His feet are just like he was when he was standing. And his view is toward the person who might be looking at the statue. So we think this is the best model of Robert that we could get. This was created by Ned Giberson and built entirely of bronze in the final statue. It weighs over 1,000 pounds and stands on the campus of the SIU Dental School on College Avenue. The actual head is this plaster cast. That's the actual size of the statue and the actual size, as far as he could tell, of Robert's actual head. He made a lot of measurements from photographs, these that I showed you in the case, and he determined that that's the size that the head should be. In order to do it right, we had to pay him a lot of money. And so this is a copy of the check that we gave him for his first installment. We gave him other money beside this, but this is a large check given to him for the first installment. Now this is a book that is telling us all about Robert's life. It was written by a doctor of English at Shurtleff College, which is a college that is where the dental school is now. And Dr. Fadner wrote the book 2 years after Robert died, but he talked to a great many people. He got a lot of stories and a lot of information, and he wrote this nice little book. We have this for sale at the museum, and it's a good biography of Robert, the gentle giant.
This is the lie room here.
here in this picture up here are the four men who were born and raised on the top of State Street. And they got into the river business. And of course, today they're all gone. But there's one son left. And he's in St. Louis, and he's in his 70s. He's not too active, but his son-in-laws are taking care of the business. Now, they have loaned all of these pictures and all this paraphernalia here, and the tools, the pictures of the boats to us. And you can see that this is typically a riverboat, steamboat era.
What about the megaphone? Is that just what
captain? That's the way they talked back and forth in those days. And you can pick that up and you can just see how easy it is for your voice to catch. And,
hello!
How would you like to have used that many years ago?
Hello!
Rudy Valley.
These boats are all wood construction. And, of course, except they're in boilers and so on. And they all were coal-fired. Most of them were. And at times, they used to carry a little flat deck barge for their supply of coal if they were going up the river very far. And that was their source of power, was the burning of the coal to make the steam. Here is Eagle Packet Company. That's one of the names that the Lye brothers had. Eagle Packet Company. They used to have on their boats.
Every day somewhere.
Every day somewhere. And that's their old cash register they used to use on the excursion boats.
Eagle Boat Store.
Eagle Boat Store. Here it is, Eagle Packet Company. And this is the way they steer the boat. This way. And ordinarily, you'd stand on this side or that side, and you just bring it up and take it down. And that's the way you'd steer the boat. Now, if on normal conditions, there'd be only one person here. But if the water was swift or one thing or another, and we'd probably need more help to control the boat, or there'd be one man standing on this side and one man standing on that side. And that's the way they would steer up and down the river. Now here's the way, this is the way they used to ring the bells. One bell would start and go forward, two bells would go a little farther, third bell was to stop. Here's the way the bells work. Now they're not connected, so you don't have to worry about that. Now coming on down this way, this is the way the modern towboats today steer. See, we have the two levers here that we steer the steel the boats today. And this is for a twin screw boat for two propellers and two rudders. And this is the way you control it. Now here is the old steamboat, the way they used to transmit between the pilot house and the engine room. This would be up in the pilot house, and this would be down in the engine room. And you see, whatever you do, this would be recorded down there, and whatever you record down there would come here. And that's the way they used to, in the engine room, would get their messages from the pilot house to the engine.
What's this for right here?
That was for a bell out on the in the bow of the boat. Ring the bell similar to this particular. But today, the boats we have on the modern towboats, we have them only for emergency, ringing in case of emergency.
This is a map of the navigable waters in the Midwest. There's 9,000 miles of waterways. Now, we go from Tampa, Florida over there, go all the way up to Pittsburgh, we go to Chicago, St. Paul, Sioux City, and Tulsa, and we come all the way down to Houston, and all the way down farther to Corpus Christi. There's 9,000 miles there. And where it's heavy black, that means that the river is at least 9 feet or more. You'll see some of the light blue and some of the dashes. That means it's under 9 feet.
So in our transportation, we always are careful that, all the big streams that we operate on are 9 feet or more.
This is a model of the first railroad station that was built in Alton. It was actually a warehouse that was used to store goods that were brought in by boat and carried by train then to Springfield, Illinois, which was the end of the line as far as Alton was concerned. Captain Benjamin Godfrey was the man who started the railroad system here, and the first thing he did was to build a large warehouse to contain all the goods that would be shipped in later years. He then started the railroad system that went up Piasau Street to Godfrey and then across country to Springfield eventually. Godfrey was the man for whom the city of Godfrey is named, but when he came to Alton area, it was only a prairie grounds. There was nothing there but a prairie. That is the grassy area where the Indians used to live and the cattle used to roam, and that was all he found when he came to this area. But he was one of our good businessmen, started the railroad station, then the railroad, and many other things in Alton. Some of the trains required water. This is a water tank. There would be a pipe leading over here, dropping down to the top of the engine where they put the water, and that engine stopped there for water one day. We also had an electric system. If you can see this little streetcar, that was run by electricity. See the two trolleys that connected to a wire that ran all the way from Alton to St. Louis. The railroad bridge across the river is an interesting thing. This was built in 1894. It was dedicated in May of 1894 and still swings back and forth every day, allowing the trains to come across and the boats to come by when it's open.
Elijah Parrish Lovejoy. He was born in 1802 in Albion, Maine, to a farm family. He attended Colby College in Waterville, Maine, where he graduated with honors. He taught for a while in Maine, and feeling the cry from westward migration, he headed west to St. Louis, where he became a teacher and for a time wrote articles for the St. Louis Times. Shortly thereafter, he embraced the Christian religion. After embracing the Christian religion, he entered the seminary in Princeton University, after which became a licensed preacher. Again, he headed west to St. Louis, where he became the editor of a religious paper known as The Observer. And because of its staunch views on a smoldering issue of slavery, they came under fire almost immediately. Also, he was the minister of the Pear Presbyterian Church and met his wife, Cecilia French. The issues became very controversial, and he had to flee St. Louis, and he fled to Alton. But the persecutions did not cease. Instead, they picked up in intensity. He was assailed more than once. In fact, he was given three press, actually four. He lost all three to mob violence. Taking a very staunch, very deliberate stand, on the fourth press, determined, he lost his life. He lost his life here in Gilman's warehouse, assailed by a mob of many trying to keep alive these beliefs, these ideals, the principles by which we today believe in.
That's cute.
I'm glad you like our gift shop.
You have so many nice things in here.
Now this might fit one of the boys.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Right, boys.
And then this one might fit the other one.
Right.
How does that feel?
Oh,
do you like
it? Oh, look at that.
Oh, how neat. Pius on one side and Robert Watlow on the other. Goodness, what luck
wow.
we found
mine
at the gift
the,
shop.
Mine's the same, too.
Good, good. We've had a good time, haven't we? We've learned a lot and look at all the nice things we found.
What do you think of the t-shirt, Dad?
Looks great.
Good. Good. Okay.
We're awfully glad that you came to see us today. And you do know that we have changing exhibits. There are regional artists that have different exhibits in the gallery, and we have different history exhibits. So come back. Come back when you could stay longer.
We will.